Good morning, Unity. A few things before I start. First, I wanted to recognize, I meant to do this last week, but with everything that was happening and God's presence was moving last week, I didn't, so forgive me. But I wanted just to recognize Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And first, actually, I know Mandy's not here. I saw Aunt Roberta. But if you are a conqueror or survivor, please stand. Amen. If you know anybody that was a kind, that would be everybody because we all know Mandy. But what I wanted to do is just a few things real quickly is I want to celebrate anyone who has survived, but also pray. Oh, Aunt Roberta. Everybody give Aunt Roberta a hand. Sorry. Actually, stay standing for 1 second. Stay standing for 1 second. And we're just going to pray just real quickly. Because they've beaten it. They've conquered their living life. They're a testimony. We're going to pray over them that that continues to be the case. That they stay healed, healthy, and that they continue to move forward. But also, after I do that, I just want to pray for those who have been affected, those who have experienced loss at the hand of this very evil disease. So, Father, we thank you, Lord God, for every survivor that is here today, those who are not, that are part of the Unity family, Lord God. First, we just praise you. We thank you for their life. We thank you that they are here to proclaim the goodness of the Lord, Lord God, that they can tell their testimony, Lord, that they can give other people hope. Lord God, that there is a God and there is healing available and that there is life even after some of our darkest moments, Lord God. And so we pray over them right now. We ask for your continued health and your and healing, that they would see the fullness of their days, Lord God, and with long life, you will satisfy them, Lord God, in Jesus' name. And even now, Lord God, I pray for everyone, Lord God, who's experienced or been impacted by this disease, by cancer at all, Lord God. And I just pray that you would not allow any cynicism to take root, that you would allow, Lord God, that you would cause, rather, even the pain of those types of situations, Lord God, to cause us to draw near to you. You are the only one with the answers, Lord God. You are the only one who can help us understand, Lord God, and make something beautiful out of something even that dark and that painful, Lord God. So I pray over everyone here who has experienced loss, who has been impacted in any way by it, Lord God. And I just pray that you lift them up in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Even while I'm praying, Father, I thank you for this time of teaching, and I thank you for what you want to accomplish today, what you're leading us into today. I pray that our hearts would be good soil, our minds would be good soil, that you could plant seed, Lord God, and that it would run deep, that we would water it, cultivate it, and that it would bear good fruit. And so as we engage with your word this morning, and as we engage with you this morning, I pray, Lord God, that you accomplish everything, that you facilitate everything that you want to do today. In Jesus' name, amen. We've been in the series, Foundations of Worship. Today will be the last message in this series. And it's interesting, God initially told us he wants us to do a series on worship, and he let us know, I want to do Foundations of Worship. But as we began to prepare messages and as people began to teach, it was clear that God centralized our focus on the substance and the authenticity of our worship rather than just the acts or the expressions of our worship. And I think God was intentional in doing that, even as we talked about, if you weren't here, you can go back and look at it or not. I'm about to say it right now. We talked about the fact that it's like a faucet, and you can turn the faucet on and off, but that does not inherently mean that what's coming out is pure water. And so we can lift our hands, we can do the things. That in and of itself is not necessarily our worship, but expressions of worship. We have to concentrate first on the substance, the authenticity, the worship really from our lives that leads up to the expressions of worship. And so, so we spent all of this time, the last like 2 months, kind of allowing God to help us lay that foundation. And so I think it's interesting because now we get to the point, I think today, where we can, now that foundation is laid, we can properly look at the beauty the power, the privilege of expressions of worship. And so today, what I want to talk about is, why do we do that? Why do we clap? Why do we sing? Why do we raise hands? Is it just something we do because we're church people and we came to church one day, or our parents took us to church and that's what people do, and so that's what we do? Or is there something more? And I think that in church, either these things, these expressions, first of all, they're like a caricature. If you watch a movie and there's people doing it, we're imitated more than any other religious group on earth. But I think there's something to that. But when you walk into an environment like this, it can easily be one of two things. Either it can be a little awkward or unfamiliar if it's not something you've experienced before, if it's not something that you're used to, or it can be so normal, something that we're so used to that we just do it. We don't think about what's behind what we're doing. We don't understand the meaning of what we're doing. We kind of do it, and God is faithful, and God honors our expressions of worship, so he meets us there. But I believe that even as it says in Proverbs, that we are to get wisdom, and with all our getting, get understanding. And that's what will even further empower our worship. Are you with me?
Yes.
So today, what I want to do is actually, I'm going to be short so that we can actually have some lab. So the class work is done. Now it's time to take action on what we've been talking about and to release what's in us once we understand some of these other things. It's this, even as I studied this week, the challenge is, once you dig into anything in God's word, it's alive, it's active, it's robust, it is quite vast. And so even looking at just the words used for praise and worship, there are 90 to 100 words that I looked at, the meanings for, but we're not gonna do that today. we're just going to look at 7 to 9, 7 with like kind of 2 honorable mentions. Most of these you would have heard already. But a couple of things real quickly before we start. I want us to understand there's an argument even in the church that expressions of worship are an Old Testament thing. The problem with that is that you're misunderstanding, if you have this misconception, you're misunderstanding what the Old Covenant was. There are things that happened in the time of the Old Covenant that were not necessarily attached to or prescribed by the covenant. Does that make sense? So the law was in place, and there were certain acts of worship, certain things that they did in the temple that were required by the law. I'm not saying we have to express. I'm saying we should. I'm married to Shani.
Amen.
I expect at least you to be like, yeah. Nope, you're fired. You're fired. Nope. I don't have to say I love you, but I should. I don't have to say I love you, but doing so enriches the relationship, connects us on a deeper level. Most of the time, especially with men, if you meet a man that just refuses to say, I love you, he's more concerned about himself than the one he's supposed to be loving. I'm going to stay right here. I'm going to stay right here. I felt it. I felt it bubbling. Huh? We're going to stay right here because we got some lab to do. We don't have to, but we should. I think there's enough biblical precedent, and there are enough models of what our established norms should be for worship once we enter the kingdom of God. I think there's enough in God's word to help us understand that even if it doesn't match our personal bents, our personalities, or the things that we're comfortable with, we are supposed to express worship. And part of moving into, if you're one of those people that's more reserved, one of those people who's a little bit resistant because that's just not me, it doesn't take all that. Part of moving into kingdom culture and Christian lifestyle is adopting different norms. We move from darkness to light. Yeah. We move from grudges to forgiveness. Yeah. The list goes on and on. So us, our personalities and our bents don't really give us a reason not to express worship once we've entered into the light. It can be awkward, it can be uncomfortable, but the question you have to ask yourself is it biblical? And is God worthy of my uncomfortability? Praise him. Richard Foster, a Quaker theologian born a very long time ago, born in 1942. That's not that long ago, actually. I thought my notes said 1842. And even all week as I looked at this in my brain, it said 1842. And I looked just now, like a long time ago, 1942. It's not that long ago. But he said this: often our reserved temperament is little more than fear of what others will think of us, or perhaps an unwillingness to humble ourselves before God in others. Of course, people have different temperaments, but that must never keep us from worshiping with our whole being. Must never keep us from worshiping with our whole being. And even as we talked about Romans 12:1 last week, that scripture implores us to, in view of God's mercy, offer our bodies. Expressions of worship are expressed through our expressions of worship are expressed through our
bodies.
All right. So maybe for you, your first act of worship is just the willingness to do it. It may just be the willingness to get past your bents, what's normal for you, what you wouldn't do anywhere else. Maybe you're one of those people at the Penn State game to be like you're not even screaming there. This is the place still that is calling for more from you. Let's skip ahead a little bit before we start. Again, if worship is a response, I have to ask myself, if I'm resistant to worship expression, am I more concerned or focused on myself or God? And what is an adequate response to him? So all of us have natural bents, personality traits, things that we have that we will have to bow or submit to God and who he said we should be. So even if you're uncertain, even if you're hesitant, I think you should always, all of us will always need to just be willing to put aside anything that seems natural to us to be free in what God really called us to. Okay? All right. So again, why do we do that? Why do we clap? Why do we sing? Why do we raise hands? Two questions for us today. Does the Bible teach us that worship is an appropriate response to God and who he is, and that we should express worship to him? The answer is yes. Second, does the Bible define what expressions of worship should generally look like and sound like? Yes. We can all worship in our own way, but it's like Target. We're all gonna wear a red shirt. You can choose which shirt, but it's gotta look a certain way. And so let's go over the 7 most commonly used Hebrew words for praise. And again, 2 sort of honorable mentions. And all of these, I want you to understand, these are actions, almost like when I wave hello, right? What's up, Jess? Hello. You see that? I didn't even have to say anything, she waved back. Understand what the gestures are and what's behind them. Okay, that's what we're going over today. Some of the words. First, halal. This is sort of an overarching word, so I wanted to start with that word. It's the primary Hebrew word, root word for praise. It is to boast, to rave, to celebrate, to shine, to shout. That's not for all of, I'm a black church folk, that's not this shout. It's an actual shout with your mouth, okay? To break out in a cry, to be clamorously foolish, to make a fool of or act madly like a madman. It's pretty descriptive. Psalm 150 is where we get this from. It says, it's one of the places, one of the many places we get it from, but let everything, you've heard this before, let everything that has breath praise or halal the Lord. Everything that has breath. The crazy Christian people, the outgoing, exuberant people, no. Everything that has breath, halal the Lord. So to halal is to boastfully shine in our expression of praise to God in a way that is out loud, exuberant, and could be seen as foolish. That's halal. The next two that we have are pretty similar. First one is yada, means to cast, to throw with extended hands. 2 Chronicles 20 and 21 says, give thanks or yada to the Lord, for his loving kindness is everlasting. Psalm 63:4 says, I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. There's three Hebrew letters that make up yada. It's yad, dalet, and he. That means open. Yad means open, dalet means door, and he means grace. And so the Hebrew mind could see this phrase as meaning lift hands that open the door to grace. Wow. And so to yada is to take gratitude, worship, and praise that is within and symbolically throw or give or cast it to God. Yes. With my actions, that's what I'm saying with my yada. Second one that's similar is toda. It has the same root as yada, but there's some more nuance and a little more that we'll cover here. This will be the longest one we cover. It means an extension of the hand, an adoration or avowal. Which means of affirmation of the truth of what you believe. So an extension of the hand, an adoration or an affirmation of the truth of what you believe. Also it means to offer hymns and songs of thanksgiving, or also is used as a word for a sacrifice, a giving, an offering of praise or thanksgiving. And it seems to be more related with offering of something. Psalm 50:14 says, sacrifice thanks offerings to God, fulfill your vows to the Most High. And then in verse 23, it says, those who sacrifice thank offerings honor me, honor God. The interesting thing about toda is that it gets specific about the extending of our hands and the symbolism of this extending of our hands in two ways. First, it's a praise rendered by acknowledging or confessing sin and abandoning it. So even our toda can be used as a symbolism, as an outward action of an inward decision, of an acknowledgement of sin, of repentance, and turning away from that sin. So even on our worship, our expression of worship to God can be an outward display of, Lord, this thing that you've been dealing with in me, I give it to you. Ezra 10 and 11 talks about this, but then in Joshua 7, 19 through 20, it says, then Joshua said to Achan, who had taken some things that God said leave to him. God said, these are mine, these are devoted things. But Achan took it. And something was going on. And so Joshua approached him and said, my son, give glory to God. Give glory to the Lord, the God of Israel, and honor him with your song, Tell me what you have done. Do not hide it, bring it into the light. And how did Achan reply? He said, it is true. I have sinned against the Lord. And it makes sense that we would use this word for a sacrifice of praise. Is that we would take the thing that our flesh wants to love and sacrifice it before the throne of God with our toda. The second sort of way that gets more specific than yada that is that it denotes thanksgiving for things not yet received. My goodness. Psalm 56, 11 through 12. It's kind of pieced together. It's not all of it. You can write that down and go read it in full. It says, in God I have put my trust. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? I will render praises or toda to you. So I put my trust in God because I believe he will protect me. I believe he will provide for me. So my extending of the hands can be an expression of, God, I trust you even for the things based on your character, based on your goodness, based on what you've done before. I trust you for the things I'm hoping for, things I'm believing for, the things I am expecting to see. So toda is to extend our hands and use our voice to symbolize or express an offering of our adoration, our gratitude, an affirmation of the truth of what we believe, an act of surrender, acknowledgement of forsaking our sin, and a thanksgiving based on faith in God. Just a few more. Our Shabbat is to shout or continually shout, to laud, to lift, to exalt, to address in a loud tone. Somebody say loud.
Loud.
Somebody say quiet. Somebody say loud.
Loud.
Is the Bible descriptive about what these things should look and sound like? Is the Bible descriptive?
Yes. Yes.
Do we get to decide for ourselves what our worship should look like? Should we rely on what the Bible says it should look like?
Yes.
That's why we're doing this. That's why we're doing this. Shabbat. It means to commend and to triumph. Psalm 63:3 says, because your love is better than living itself, my lips will glorify you. In response to what I see and understand about your love, I'll open my mouth.
Yes, yes.
There's three letters involved in this. Sheen, bet, and it says chet, but it's pronounced het. And that's to destroy house and division or offense. So to Shabbat, when we Shabbat the Lord, it has the power to destroy division in the house, soul and spirit, flesh and spirit, in the house, in my house, my home. So my Shabbat, my willingness to open my mouth beyond a conversational tone to Shabbat the Lord has the power to destroy divisions. Hallelujah. Barak, to kneel down. Why do we sometimes kneel and get on our knees? Why do we lay prostrate before the Lord on our faces? We're baraking the Lord. It means to kneel down, to kneel on knees, to bless God as an act of adoration, or to salute. Psalm 95 through 6 through 7 says, come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our maker. For he is our God, and we are his people, the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. 1 Chronicles 29:20 says, then David said to all the assembly, now bless or barak the Lord your God. So all the assembly blessed, baraked the Lord God of their fathers, and bowed their heads and prostrated themselves before the Lord and before the king. Psalm 34:1 says, I will bless, barak the Lord at all times. Now, how do you kneel before the Lord at all times? There's another scripture that says, rend your hearts, not your garments, speaking of an inward posture. So even if I don't, if I'm at my job, if I'm driving, if I'm doing something that doesn't allow me to bend my knees, I can bend my knee in here. I can humble and lower myself in here. But in doing it physically, again, what I'm doing is I'm expressing. I feel the need to humble myself before the Lord, to become low under his word, to become low in his presence. And I express that physically, giving him a barak. There's three parts, and one reference said three words to this, to barak. It's bet, resh, and kaf, or haf, sorry. That's how you say that. And that's house, and that's head or first, supreme, greater, right? Like the head, and palm or open hand. And so the Hebrew mind could see this as blessing the head of a house with an open hand. The next one is zamar, to make music. I was just pointing at my corner. To make music and celebrate in song, to pluck the strings of an instrument, unless it's a harp, Shani. To sing, to praise. It denotes joyful expressions of music with an instrument. Psalm 57 says, awake, O my soul, awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I'll get up early. Awaken the dawn. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you. I will sing about you. I will zamar you among the people. There's three parts to this word, Zayin, Mem, and Resh. That's sword, life, or water. And then again, Resh, which is first, greater, it's the head, it's the leading thing. So it's a sword that gives life to the hearer. Life or water, refreshing to the hearer. Couple more. Tehillah. This is also derived from halal. It means to sing or laud, to lift or exalt. It's perceived to involve music, especially singing, songs of the spirit or praise. Now, what's unique is that it can be a new song, a song that's fresh, just from your heart. Not songs that we put on the screen, but from your heart, even prophetically, just singing a new song, a song that's not been written unto the Lord. It's an act of public praise. It's to give God renown, fame, or glory. Here's the interesting part. It's a praise that is demanded by the qualities, deeds, or attributes of God. So upon seeing who he is, it's a praise that is not like God is demanding you, but upon seeing it, how can you help but not give him this praise? Who God is places a demand. If you really see and understand and hear and feel inside of who you are, who God is, that places a demand of worship on you. Not like somebody had to get up and say, hey, lift your hands before. No. I've seen God. I've tasted and seen. So I can't help but it's placing a demand on the worship that's in me. But are we seeing him on a regular basis on Tuesday morning? Thursday afternoon. So tehillah is to sing, to give voice to the Holy Spirit through song, to release a new and spontaneous song. It's a response to who God is and what he has done. The last two are for a clap and for dancing. First one is kind of, I've meshed sort of three different terms together. It's karar, gual, and makola. To leap or to dance, to rejoice, to go around and about, to spin around, dancing. It's a toy, again, token of joyfulness or joyousness after a victory. And we see an example of this with David, as we know, in 2 Samuel 6:14. It says, then David danced before the Lord with all his might. So these terms mean, it's really deep. If you're writing this, if you're taking notes, it means to move your body. Somebody look at your neighbor. Let's wake up for a second. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, good morning. Good morning. Now look at him again and say, I like to move it, move it. Last word, taka, means to clap. It's a blast. It's to give a strike or a blow. To give a pledge, it's used as a part of a pledge. Like, on my mom, I'm just joking. Praise him. But here's the amazing part. It's also a word that's used for the action of thrusting a weapon into your enemy. Uh-huh. Give him praise, Becca. Psalm 47, 1 through 2 says, oh, clap your hands, all ye peoples. Some of you peoples. All you peoples. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is a great king over all the earth. So taka means to clap. Super deep. But if you think about clapping, even people that don't know God, it's sort of a natural response and a reaction throughout the history of man. You would see people in approval or an applause of something, in celebrations of something, and even while they're laughing and enjoy, just to clap. It's part of how God made us. It's part of how God made us. So let's just give that natural part of us back. How could we be hesitant to even just clap before the Lord when it's so natural to being a human? All right, so can you put that chart of words? I'm not sure if you're going to be able to see this or not. But let's look at what all these words sort of mean. We're looking at why do we do what we do? Why do we do that? And so these are all the words at the top: halal, yada, toda, shabak, barak, zamar, tahila, karar, and takah. Halal really is all of them things. It's the lifting or extending of our hands, to sing or raise our voice, to kneel, bow, or be made low, to humble ourselves, to make music, to clap, to dance. But then what you'll see is the words, when God tells us to praise and to worship Him, all of the words that are included involve something active.
Yes.
Not just being in the environment, not just being in our living room, just standing. There's something about praise and worship and how the Bible describes it that always, expressions of praise and worship, that always involves some kind of activity, being active before the Lord. And so that's really what I wanted to get us to today, is because we're going to spend some time even now practicing these things, doing these things. And what I want us to do is find a way to take our mind off of even what we're doing and place it on God.
Yes.
Place it on who He is.
Yes.
Place it on what you're expecting Him to do.
Yes.
Place it on what you need to surrender to Him. Because even, again, universal signs of surrender. An army pulls up on another army, they say, put your hands up, surrender. I surrender to your will. So again, does the Bible teach us that to worship? Yes. How? It teaches us to worship in ways that are demonstrative and demonstrated. And that's not just here. We're going to practice here. But I love what I think David said. If you can't worship here in an environment where everybody wants to worship anyway, how where do you find the strength to do it on Tuesday when you really need God's presence? So use this place as practice. Use this place to find some freedom. The great part about God is that what He's going to do, He's going to meet us when we yield ourselves to Him. He's going to allow us to experience His presence, His power, His deliverance. Everything that He is found in His presence. And so if our focus is on Him, He'll tend to us. He'll draw us near. Just, and again, like I said several times, just remember that these are outward actions that we want to be fueled by a substance that's inward. But we want to do these things to connect with God. And God is just drawing us near. He's a father. He's a shepherd. He gave us these tools, these actions as a way to connect with Him, to draw near to Him, along with prayer, along with His word, along with community. But it's such a privilege that the God and the King of the universe would desire intimacy and connection with us. That will give us a way that there's not all these barriers anymore. It's simply if we lean in and worship Him, He's right here with us. So again, even now, as the worship team comes, be intentional about your focus on Him. Be intentional about directing your focus and saying, God, what's inside that I can pour out to You right now? Even if you're not sure, sometimes the unlocking of that door is merely leaning in. It's merely taking action. It's merely being willing. And I promise you that God is here to connect and to show you something new, to reveal Himself like you've never seen Him, to do something in your heart and in your soul. So let's meet with the King of the universe even now. Amen.
Hallelujah. Father, You are so worthy of our praise. Every part of our body worships You. You are worthy of our praise. If we have movement in our limbs right now, we move them to worship you, God, to give you glory, Lord. Thank you, Lord. There's coming a time where every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess our God is Lord of Lords, but we know that now. That time is now for us. So we worship you, God. We bow our knee. We bow the knees of our hearts, Lord God. We rend our hearts today to you, Father, to the King of Glory. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. We stand here, Lord, and we do not forget your benefits. You're an amazing God. You're an amazing God. You're an amazing God. We are your people. No one has to talk us into that. We know you're an amazing God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you for the understanding of why we do what we do, Lord God. Thank you for that, God, because you are worthy. You are worthy. Your goodness demands that from us. So we give you praise. We give you praise. Oh, King of Glory, King of Glory. You're the King, you're the King. We bow before the King. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King. So let's start right now. Why would we wait? Oh, King of Glory, fill this place. I just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you. You are the King of Glory. Please fill this place. Just wanna be with you. We just wanna be with you. Yes, the world,
yes, the world
will
bow down and say you are God. Victory.
different now. Hallelujah. Hits a little different.
And I'll dance in your presence till you come again.
One more time.
Say, I'll sing hallelujah till you come again.
Hallelujah.
And I'll dance in your presence till you come again.
My whole being will praise you. I will sing.
I will sing hallelujah
till you come.
Till you come again.
And I'll dance in your presence.
Do God.
Oh, dance in your presence till you come. We'll sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
Till you come.
Till you come.
He's worthy of the highest praise. He's worthy of the highest praise.
Dance in your presence till you come again.
While we wait, we'll sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
Until you come again, we'll dance.
Dance in your presence till you come again.
My whole being will praise you, Lord. I'll sing.
Sing hallelujah.
Till you come.
Till you come.
There's joy in the waiting. I'll dance in your presence.
Dance in your presence. just want to be with you.
We just want
to be with you.
We just want
to be with you.
We just want
to be with you.
Just want to worship 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 you.
Just from the depths of our being.
We just want to worship you.
Just want to worship you.
We just want to worship you. Imagine
just that. Want to worship you.
Just 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 want to
worship you. It's just you and him. Just want to worship you.
Just want to worship you.
I just want to worship you.
I just want to worship you.
Woo! Just worship him. Just worship him. It's you and him. It's you and him. Let the new song come. Let the new song come. Let the new song come.
Woo,
Jesus. Just want to worship you.
Just want to be with you.
Woo. Your presence.
Just want to be with you.
Your presence.
Just want to sing to you.
Woo. Let the new song.
Just want to sing to you.
Oh, we delight in you.
Just want to dance for you.
We delight in you, oh God.
Just want to dance for you.
Worship him, worship him.
Just want to worship you.
From the depths of our soul.
Just want to worship you.
We remove that division. I command my soul to bless the Lord. I command my soul to bless the Lord. I command my mind to bless the Lord. I command my heart to bless the Lord. I command my hands to bless the Lord. I command my feet to bless the Lord. I just want to worship you. Imagine that we just want to worship.
Just want to sing.
Ooh, just want to worship you.
Just want to sing.
Just want to worship you.
Just want to worship you.
Just want to worship. I know some of us had a whole lot on our minds today. A whole lot on our minds today. But imagine right now. All we want to do, all we want to do is worship God. Imagine that. All we want to do. Outside is still out there. Whatever you were thinking about when you came in, it's still there. But imagine right now, all we want to do is give God what he is due. All we want to do. And show God how much we love him. All we want to do is show God how much we have the opportunity right now, right now, right now, to offer hearts of gratitude, to offer him our thanksgiving, to offer him our praise, to offer him everything that he is worthy of, to give him all the glory. Hallelujah, we just want to worship you, God. We just want to worship you, Lord. We only want to worship you, God. Hallelujah. Receive it all right now. Receive it all right now. Receive it all right now. We just want, we just want, we just want. We just want you. We just want you. Take everything, God. We just want you. Hallelujah. We just want you. We just want you. We won't tire of giving you your praise. We won't tire of giving you your praise. We worship you. We worship you. Hallelujah. The very one that gave us breath to worship. The very one that gave us a mouth to give him praise. We just want to worship you. We just want. Woo! I speak to every part of me that doesn't, and I say you will worship. You will worship. You will worship. Speak to every part of you that says, man, you will worship. You will worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are God and King. You are God and King. You are God and King. And we worship. And we worship. And we worship. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Hallelujah. Oh, come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me. Hallelujah. Oh, we won't back up. Hallelujah. Jesus, because all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah, and I know it's not much, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for this heart singing hallelujah. So I throw up my hands. I praise you again. For some of us, that's just surrender right now. All that I have is a
hallelujah.
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 Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And I know it's not much. I've nothing else fit for a king. Except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I throw up my hands. I'll praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a
come on.
praise you again and again. Cause all that I have is a hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I know it's not much.
Not much.
I've nothing else fit. Except for hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord God, we give you all we have to give. Woo. We give you our best praise, God, our best praise. We hold nothing back. We hold nothing back. We hold nothing back. Hallelujah. We hold nothing back. Say, withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Woo. We hold nothing back. We hold nothing back. We give you all we have. Everything that we are is yours, Lord. May our worship be sweet to you. May our worship be sweet to you. May our praise be a sacrifice. May our praise be a sacrifice. We offer ourselves to you. Living, breathing, moving, sacrifices. We want to be holy and acceptable. Holy and acceptable. Holy and acceptable.
Just wanna worship you. This is the air I breathe. Mm. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. My God, this is my daily bread. You are my daily bread. Your very word spoken in me. This is the air I breathe.
This is the air I breathe.
God, you are the air I breathe.
This is the air I breathe.
Mm-hmm. Daily bread.
This is my daily bread.
Oh, this is my daily bread.
This is my daily bread.
Yes.
Oh, your very words
spoken. And I'm
Nothing
of our worship, and you alone deserve our praise. You alone deserve the honor, so we lift you high, Yahweh. Your Adonai,
Yahweh, Yahweh,
we lift you high,
Yahweh, Yahweh,
for you alone deserve our worship.
and all the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, "You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. Yes, you deserve the glory. You are worthy of it all. Yes, you are worthy of it all. For from you are all things. Jesus, to you are all things. You deserve the glory." All the saints.
All the saints and angels
bow before
your throne.
And all the elders cast their crowns.
All the elders cast their crowns before the
end.
Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise.
Let my praise arise to you,
Jesus. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise.
Let it rise.
Come on, team.
Let it rise. Let the praises arise. Let it rise.
Let it rise.
Let the praises arise.
Let your praises arise.
One more time. One more moment. Just in your own words. Not anything anybody's telling you to do. Let's just release a worship of praise to our God. If you want to kneel, kneel. If you want to stand, stand. Whatever God is calling for in this moment from you. But I encourage every person, lift your voice. I hear God saying he's filling the empty right now. I hear God saying he's filling the empty right now. Come on, let your praise rise. He's filling the empty right now. Whoa, God. Jesus. Freedom is here. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you break the yoke of bondage right here in your presence. Thank you that freedom is here. That we yield to you. Sin has no place. stronghold is broken. Not by power, not by might, but by your Spirit. Cleanse and purify us, God. Burn out everything that's not like you. But Lord, that place that we've been trying to get free from, the place we've been trying to break, you break it now. Thank you.
I just feel led to share with you all something that I think has been said multiple times through the sermon series, but I feel the Lord really pressing it on me again today. This action, worshiping, raising your hands, praising, that is where your deliverance is. That is where our deliverance is. I just have the image, comes from the Old Testament, of the valley of dry bones, and I just see a flood rushing over, a flood rushing over, bringing life, bringing newness, bringing freshness, bringing deliverance. And it starts with this, it starts with praise. The praise is not for the other side. The praise is not for the other side. And I say this from experience. The Lord has, I've been taken through some dark valleys of physical sickness. And there is a relief. There is a relief that comes when wellness comes again. But there is nothing like praise that delivers us in it.
Yes.
The praise that lifts our eyes in it. That is just as sweet. So I say to the people in this room who are in it right now, who are in the valley, whose bones feel dry, who feel like they're breaking with the dryness, there is refreshment here. We are drawing from a well. This is not just our own energy, our own strength, our own fervor, our own excitement. We are all in this moment drawing from a well. There is refreshment here. Your deliverance is here. It's here. Don't leave this room with that same knot of dryness in your heart. There is praise to be given right now. And I promise you, the Lord promises you, that is where your deliverance is. This whole time we've been singing, I've just been reminded of the Alleluia refrain, and I'm wondering if we can sing it.
Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia.
Sing it over yourself.
Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia.
God, and we will worship you right now. Father, I declare for everyone in this room, Father, no matter what we're going through, yes, our praise is now, yes, God. Lord. No, yes, matter, Lord, what we're dealing with, no matter the sickness, hallelujah, in our bodies, no matter, hallelujah, the pain that is in our mind, God, no matter what has passed and what is to come, God, we will praise you. We will praise you while we wait, God. We will praise you because you are worthy of praise. Even now, God, you are worthy of praise. We will sing hallelujah. We will sing hallelujah. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Stand on your feet. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we're just gonna close with this song. And the elders who are here to minister prayer, would you come? Keep singing. Hallelujah. Savior, this is a good, this is the time. Come, the elders will lead you into the salvation, or if you have a need, they will pray with you. Worthy is the Lamb. Say, you are holy. You are holy. Holy are you, Lord God. I said, you are dismissed, but we're going to dismiss worshiping. So, okay, just worship as you go. And if you need prayer, come and receive prayer. Or if you need to restoration in your relationship with the Lord, come and receive prayer about that. If you don't know the glorious Lord Jesus, come and they will lead you into salvation. You are dismissed.